Dumb and Busted Pop Quiz Hotshot.
Kay, hit me.
A pervy arsonist who has a weird thing for men's shoes.
Episode 5, Fire Starter.
Yes. Twins who box for work and murder for fun.
Episode 42, Cray Cray.
Yes. Last one. Creepiest creeper who terrorizes a family with handwritten letters.
Episode 39, Watch Out.
Hell yeah. For true crime stories of insane stupidity and exceptional genius, listen and subscribe to Dumb and Busted on iTunes, Spotify, Google, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts.
In case you can't tell by the name, Yikes, Murder and Stuff contains themes that are not suited for children. It's also no good for the workplace and probably not your meemaw and your papaw either. We're going to talk about some grim subject matter, probably make uncomfortable jokes, and we're definitely going to be cursing. But if that's something you're into, then put your headphones on and hop in our nondescript windowless van and come see the puppies.
Hey everybody, this is Acadia from Murder and Stuff, and I'm performing a coup as we speak because Jen usually does the intros, but today I'm doing it because it's a special musical episode, and
yay!
I am super musical. So, hi, Ms. Sandwich.
Hello.
And Mells. How is everybody doing?
Howdy. Everything's just peachy over here. That's all right. Could be better. Could be worse.
Well, since we all live in different locales, I would assume that it's still coldest where you are. Sandwich.
It's fucking horrible, but yeah. I'm pretty sure that where Mel's is pretty horrible.
I
also
don't think it's as bad, but it's cold and rainy and gross here. At least it's not snowing right now, but yeah, it's kind of just a gloomy day.
I don't understand any of that shit out there. Like, when people in New Mexico and Nevada tell me that it's snowing, I'm like, it's the desert, you dummies. Haven't you looked outside?
Okay, I'm going to have to just, because I live here now, I'm going to have to tell you it's Nevada, okay?
What? Like Florida?
It's Nevada, not Nevada.
No, it's Nevada.
No, I thought it was Nevada. Yeah, you're going to get kicked out.
That's how people who live in a Stephen King novel would say it.
Yeah, you know what? That's why I'm from Maine. I'm a fucking genius because it's the only state that only has one syllable.
Well, then why are you still not, why are you not living there then?
Because I'm from there and that's all that counts. Anyways.
It says, don't call it Nevada or you'll be in trouble unless one legislator. Apparently, the only acceptable pronunciation of the state is Nevada.
I will never remember that, but
no one's cutting anything out because
it's just
that's
Vegas,
a perfect
basically.
Segue because probably at some point somebody wrote a song about how they killed some fucker that mispronounced the name of their state. Like somebody from Arkansas went to Kansas and said, wow, Kansas is really beautiful. And the person in Kansas is like, fuck you, and killed him. And someone wrote a song about it, and that is the actual topic of our show this week. Murder ballads.
Hooray!
Which I wrote one, but before I give you my murder ballad, I know that, Jen, you had some important messages that you wanted to tell people.
I do. I have to thank some people because I didn't do it last week. I don't think I did it the week before either, so no excuses here. I'm just going to go ahead and thank our patrons. We have three patrons, Casey, Justin, and Carrie. Thank you all so much, and make sure and check your mail this week because we've got some fun swag coming your way. So all of that is coming in. You'll be so surprised and so happy when you see what it is. And I also wanted to thank Mells Bells. Thank you so much for the research that you did on the guillotines last week. And I hope you'll continue to come hang out with us and be our host and our helpful researcher too.
Oh, yes, of course. I would love to. I love
Yay.
To talk about the guillotine and all of the French things.
Yes, also, anything French.
We need representation from the rectangle states. So that's you now.
Well, that's I think that once you get past the Mississippi, I think Acadia thinks that every state is shaped like a rectangle.
Hey, well, it's an upside down, almost obtuse triangle, but I'm not going to go there with you again about this state.
Right, right. Here's a little, I'll give you two little pieces of amazeballs knowledge. Number one, when they originally made the colonies and then they started thinking about how they were going to, like, grow, they just basically just made all the existing colonies really long west. Like, like they just kept going and they're like, oh, well, just keep going until, like, so everything would have been like a stripe. And there still would have only been 13 states. But then the reason that Nevada has that chunk taken out of it, that little, because Nevada was supposed to be, or however you say it, was supposed to be a rectangle, except that that chunk got taken out because basically California wanted it. And at the time California became a state, they could have been their own country, so we were kind of kissing their ass, and they're like, hey, what is it going to take to get you in the Union? And they're like, that fucking chunk of Nevada over there. And they're like, okay. And that's why that's like
that. I can see it. I can see it, yeah, because that's the part of the state that is the weird angle there. Mm-hmm. So.
And Texas did the same thing. That's why Texas is so jacked up looking. Yeah, so why don't you stop...
I've lived in two funky looking states. Mm-hmm. How about that?
There's more to this, thank you. And there is our friend, Don't Kill Me Kelly, is still working on things. And I just wanted to say, Kelly, I believe in you. And I think you can do it. And we have Gee Gee Caffeine, who is related to one of the guys in The Bad Man, and she did our research for us today, so we want to send a special thank you to Miss Gigi, and we really appreciate it, and we're going to talk about that right now.
Thank you, Gigi.
Yes, we love you. We really, this is, research is so hard, and it's so really difficult because it's the heart of every single show that we do, and there's so much to do already. And for those of us who have full-time jobs, and even those of us who don't have full-time jobs and are looking for a full-time job,
yeah,
it's very, very difficult to pretty much do anything else. So everything that you do is super helpful, and you are part of the team, and we just want everybody to know that our team has gotten bigger and things are going to be awesome. So today we're talking about songs about murder. And as I was reading the research that Gigi so generously provided, this is an actual thing. There's an actual thing called murder ballads. We weren't sure if we were going to title the show Murder They Wrote or Murder They Sang or How to Win a Grammy in Prison. So, but I don't know. So I guess you kill somebody and write a song about it, and then you have a murder song. But
I killed somebody and wrote a song about it. Want to hear it? Here it goes.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Well, it's an actual thing. There's a subgenre of ballads that are called murder ballads. So there's a history of it between the 16th and the 19th centuries. There are a lot of murder ballads that came out of Britain, Ireland, and North America. They're basically something that cropped up out of oral history. They could be true. They could be fictionalized. It could be about the victim or killer, the why, the how, and the act. Like if anybody's heard of the Ballad of Lizzie Borden, which I just heard of for the first time today, and it's hysterical.
Yeah.
It is hilarious. That is the Chad Mitchell Trio, if you want to look that up. It is fantastic. So, and I loved it. She'd always done the slightest thing that Mom
and Papa bid. They said, Lizzie, cut it out.
So that's exactly what you did.
Go out for a walk. No, you can't dump your papa up in Massachusetts. Massachusetts is a far cry from New York.
Oh, but sometimes it's about escape, it's about capture, trial, punishment, execution, and basically the narrator or the singer at the end of the song is like, all right, everybody, you heard the song, don't do that, don't do it.
It's their public service announcement. It's like, I just wrote this wonderful song for you, it's beautiful, it might bring you to tears, Now let's don't kill each other, people. Thank you. Thank you.
That's it. That's all it is.
That's their Grammy acceptance speech, I think.
Yeah, you just think that somebody would just know that already, but no, we have to write a song about it. Make sure that this is the way that we tell our story. You know, don't kill. Don't kill nobody.
Well, they also, I think, were smart because then they didn't have to make up something to make the song about because they already knew what it was about.
Oh, right. Yeah, there you go.
That's why it's easy. That's why I did one on the way here.
When are we going to get around to that? Or
I'm going to do it right now because I want everyone to know how easy it was. Because I literally was like, all right, I got to write a murder song because we're doing a show about murder songs.
Okay, and let's hear it.
I mean, I don't know how to, I'm going to use a different, like, song's music, but back when they were writing these things,
there were
literally no other songs. So if you could hum any type of tune, then you would made a song because it didn't exist yet.
So the happy birthday song could be a murder song.
Yeah, so as long as you weren't ripping off, like, Gregorian chant, you were on your way.
Bop, bop, black sheep, man. Yeah, I'm ready.
And it's a mystery. You see how long it takes you to guess who it's about.
Okay.
Once there was a guy who tried to make a slave by pouring acid in his noggin, but that idea was stupid. So he just killed them in his apartment.
Okay, I'm buzzing in.
I know where he was at. Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Well,
yes. Jeffrey Dahmer.
Yeah. Yes, that's exactly right. And I didn't have to sing the last two. His name was Jeffrey Dahmer, and he was from Milwaukee.
Woo! Round of applause for that murder ballad.
That was excellent. And I feel like we should record that separately of Acadia doing the whole song to That's how you pronounce that song, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. That is.
It's
the most delicious song there's ever been.
It's yum. Oh, well, there's also some other songs, turns out. There's more than just the one that Acadia just made up the 30 seconds before.
Not to diminish the accomplishments of the other people that wrote their murder ballads.
You've missed your calling. I'm telling you, this whole time you could have been writing murder ballads, murder ballad parodies.
Right.
Well, I think you get to do the killer karaoke this week, honestly.
Wow. That would be quite an honor.
Tom Dooley, the Kingston Trio. If anybody hasn't heard that song, Acadia, can you sing a quick line of that?
Is that the one that goes, hang down your head, Tom Dooley?
That's right.
Yeah.
Hang down your head and cry.
You know what sucks? So these guys are the Kingston Trio, right?
Right.
Which
right?
puts them all, like, equal. But the one that did Ballad of Lizzie Borden, what was the name of that one?
That's the Chad Mitchell Trio. But they had
so
a Chad.
So the other two people are like, well, fuck
obviously.
You, Chad Mitchell.
Man,
unless they were all named Chad Mitchell, in which case that's the best band ever.
Oh no, but it's not though. It's just you're a typical Chad just trying to come up in the world and step on everybody else in the trio. Chad.
Fucking thank you. Hey, I said good for you, Chad. Good for you.
It's like no one, like four people could name any of the Heartbreakers, but everybody knew who Tom Petty was. So if the band has a person's name in it and that person isn't you, you can be replaced.
Yeah,
Dave Matthews, man. There you go. We don't know who's else was in the Dave Matthews band, but they're all insanely talented.
Except that violin dude with the crazy abs.
Yeah. Or I was going to say, there's like 375 people on the Dave Matthews band, so.
This is true. It's basically, they have their own zip code.
They had to whittle it down to one person, and it happened to be Dave.
So, I guess this was like a number one Billboard and Billboard R&B chart?
R&B?
What the fuck? This is the 50s, so I guess everything was R&B, so.
But yeah. They were like a folk trio, right? Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. That's why I was like, R&B? What the hell?
Huh.
So they were top 20 in Cashbox. I don't know what that is. And then it's one of the top Western songs of all time. So basically, it made all of the charts because I guess it was about killing a lady. So the murder is about something that happened in 1866. Stabbed this woman named Laura Foster in North Kakalaki, Acadia. So you should know about this, right?
Your neck of the woods.
So supposedly this happened by a soldier and a farmhand named Tom Dula. Not Tom Dooley. But his name got mispronounced because of the dialect in the area and the oral telling as it over the years. It became Tom Dooley instead of Tom Dula.
Plus those midwife assistants were pissed off. Stop calling us Dula's murderers.
Well, it involves a lover's triangle. Laura's cousin, Anne, she might have actually been the killer, was the lover of Tom. Like, this happened before he got together with Laura, so she's kind of jealous, maybe. He ended up getting Laura pregnant, and he also got her pregnant with syphilis, too, because turns out that they are all.
Is that how that's described? I'm going to have a syphilis.
Yeah, I'm gonna put a syphilis in you. let's make a syphilis, baby. So everybody's got the syphilis.
Tom
was, I guess, I don't know, the notes say Tom being a rat, but a stand-up sort of guy. I don't know. He's kind of a rat on two legs, I guess. But he basically took the fall for the whole thing and was hanged.
So he's a stand-up guy because he was like, all right, fine, I'll take the fall. You can kill me. I got, test me for the syphilis. Don't know if I got it, but.
And like rats with spreading the plague. So maybe he's like a rat spreading syphilis.
Jesus.
No offense to anyone who has syphilis, but go get that shit taken care of. The lyrics are, hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you about to die.
So, chilling.
Yes.
So basically the song is just heckling the man on his way to his death.
Yeah. Settle down, bro. You are about to be hanged. I know. Poor Tom Dooley. I feel bad for him.
People ate that shit up. It was number one.
They did. But, you know, we're not going to forget. Who knows what happened there? But, you know, justice was served, I suppose.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to see that on Cold Case Files anytime
soon. Wouldn't it be cool, though? Somebody should research what the hell happened with Tom Dooley.
Yeah, it's just a bunch of people looking at some dirt and going, I don't know where to look.
All right, there's another song that was an example of another murder ballad. Was The Twa Sisters by Loretta McKennitt.
Oh, that's how you say that?
How do you say it?
I thought it was the TWA sisters and that they had invented the airline.
And they were like, pre-Bush, they've been lobbying for this position at the airport.
Well, that's what I thought at first.
Dream
and
to
then...
make everybody late for their plane.
Yeah.
This song is actually really pretty. I listened to it, and it's the vocals are very haunting. So for it to be a murder ballad, it's very fitting in the way that it was performed also, because I had chills. It's actually a really, you know, really pretty song about murder.
Okay, so Loretta McKennitt is a singer. From these days. This is not something old, so we could look that up and see it and listen to it.
Yeah, but the song is old, right?
Yeah, it's like it first appeared on a broadside in 1656.
Yeah.
As The Miller and the King's Daughter. And it was also called The Dreadful Wind and Rain, Cruel Sister, and The Bonnie Swans.
So not only did they not have to make up many songs, they just would make up one song and then call it like five other songs. And as long as you just went like two blocks over, everyone was like, whoa, I've never heard this.
They just named the songs differently because there weren't any copyright laws back then. They could just, you know, we'll just take this song, name it something different, and it's mine now.
Yeah.
Here you go. Just like we do with memes. So I made this.
So. Yes, it's just it's got E-Bombs World under the iFunny yes. logo under yeah.
This one is about a story of two sisters who are swimming, and the older one drowns the younger, fairer one. So the old ugly sister drowned the young pretty sister. So I don't know.
I'll fix you.
Yeah. Jealousy. Jealousy. It's always the ugly. It's always the ugly girl that ends up in these situations. One of the quotes from the song is, "And there does sit my false sister, Anne, hey, ho, and me, Bobby, oh, who drowned me for the sake of a man. The swan swims so bonny, oh." And there's a rather grim part of the song that alludes to finding the body and turning her breastbone into a harp and her hair into strings and harp pins from her fingers.
I like it. I will buy this musical instrument.
It sounds awesome. I don't know how well it's going to actually play, but it'd be kind of cool to have. So
it's a talking piece.
That's called upcycling.
Right? There's a trend now where they do that with furniture. Now. Just upcycle.
No, that's right. Harps out of breastbones.
You know, if I'm going to put that in my will, I'm going to donate my body to some freak who wants to make a musical instrument out of it.
Well, you might want to tack down just who that's going to be before you do it.
The dark web, there's got to be a car.
Yeah, I'm sure, but I bet you're just going to get a bunch of necros who say, I'm going to make it a drum.
I'm going to use these femurs as drumsticks.
Yeah. Oh, I'm going to hit it, that's for sure.
Oh, no. Hey-o. So our next song is by Bob Dylan.
Yes, so that song, The Lonesome Death of Hattie Carroll, it was recorded October 23rd of 1963, and it was for his album, The Times They Are Changin', which is one of his, masterpieces, as it is considered.
It's a good one.
Yes. Though this is a true, murder ballad, it's most certainly a social commentary on racism as well. The story behind this is that Hattie Carroll was a 51-year-old African-American barmaid, and he was working in a high-class hotel in Charles City, Maryland, when a 24-year-old wealthy drunken Billy Zanzinger went on a tirade throughout the space, berating and hurling racist remarks at the staff. The next part's kind of gross. He was smacking them with a 25-cent toy cane. One server, after being called the N-word, ran out in tears. He called many of them SOBs. We all know what that stands for.
Mm-hmm.
So this was happening during a white tie event, which is really classy.
And
but
I'm thinking of a wealthy, elite, young, some guy named Chad, probably. Mm-hmm. No offense to you Chads out there. I know you're not all bad, but some of you. That was one of those wealthy, entitled dudes who just thinks he's better than everybody because he has money.
Yeah. This is the picture I'm getting in my mind. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this small film called Titanic, but the boyfriend of Rose, I believe his name was Cal. This is the picture I'm painting in my mind of
now,
Billy Zanzinger.
Billy Zane is not... That
Billy Zane is a cool dude. That's Billy Zanzinger. It's a different guy.
Did I say Billy Zane? I said Cal.
Yeah,
the
no.
Character.
But I don't know. He's just Billy Zane. He wasn't that bad. He wasn't.
Billy Zane's a cool guy.
Running around smacking people. And what? A 25-cent toy cane. Why is that such a intricate detail?
Well, how big was this 25-cent toy cane? I think of canes that I see at the Kroger, okay? I don't know if y'all know about Kroger.
I know about Kroger.
Grocery stores. Mm-hmm. The canes that are over by the pharmacy where the old people are like, oh, I think I need to pick up my prescription and a new cane. I don't think that this 25-cent toy cane is that large. So I'm thinking that it was just a nuisance, if it's this 25-cent toy cane, small thing, you're like smacking people with it. It's like, really? I mean,
I bet it wasn't even as bad as the, you know, those bats they give you, the little bats on bat day at the ballpark.
Yeah. Oh, I was thinking of those little skinny wiffle ball bats, you know, the plastic ones that are just
nah, that's too long.
I'm thinking small.
What's 25 cents back then? That's got to be like $500 now, right?
Well, yeah, if they hadn't said toy, then I would have assumed that's just how much a fucking cane cost back then.
Right.
But anyway, we could just say stick, because there's no such thing as a toy stick, because it's just a stick.
It's okay, just a stick.
Let's just go with that. But he was assaulting her with this.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. So Billy, he basically demanded a cocktail from Hattie, who was behind the bar. It took her less than a minute to finish serving another guest. So she was obviously already, you know, trying to serve someone who was in line. However, the drunk, impatient Zanzinger called her racist names and snapped his cane, striking her in the neck. She still served him. Then she proceeded to slump down and say, "I feel deathly ill. That man has upset me so." And an odd point to note is that Zanzinger also hit his wife, knocking her to the floor.
That was okay back then, though, because she continued to defend him, too. And she's just like, well, you know, like, that's how we treat black people. That's just what we do.
What kind
and
of...
That's cool. Yeah. He can smack me around. That's fine, honey. That's cool. She's completely okay with it. And she was just as bad as he was.
What? I mean, she's like, he's a stand-up guy, okay, right? Y'all? He's a stand-up guy.
What party is this? That's like, oh, yes, well, this is the cotillion. Except for Zanzinger over there, who's just going, put him up, yeah!
You know, like, it's when America was great. Back in the day, you know?
Punching bartenders, and then his wife comes up, oh, honey, that was a good punch. Oh. Well, here's one for you, whack.
We're not laughing at domestic assault or hate crimes at all.
It's the ludicrousness. Ludicrity. Here I go with my words again.
Yeah, that's a nice one.
It's
I like
the
it.
Ludicrousness
I'm writing it down.
Of it.
Maybe
right?
You should stop having your white tie affairs in saloons.
you know what? That's how shitty things were back then for women and also
people of color.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
So what happened?
Well, so Zanzinger, he was arrested for assault. Hattie did die of a stroke within hours at the hospital.
What?
Yeah, she suffered from hardening of the arteries, but the cause of death was listed as murder.
Huh.
Yep. Billy was, of course, released on bail before the court knew of Miss Carroll's passing. He was later charged with murder. Due to his family's wealth and political connections, Zanzinger won a change of venue.
He did.
Yep, for the trial before a panel of judges. He was convicted of manslaughter, which we all know is a lesser degree of first-degree murder, right?
Mm.
He served 6 months in the county jail, didn't even go to a prison. His sentence was handed down in September of 63. This was the same day as Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech.
Oh, that couldn't have come at a better time.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, people taken to the streets, that was perfect.
Yeah, but that same thing basically happened like the other day, like as far as verdicts and shit go. So that's encouraging.
Yeah, not much has changed there, I see. Well, of course, Billy was released in time to get his tobacco crop in and lead a fairly quiet life, becoming a landlord to, guess what, low-income people of color. The irony is not lost on that, correct?
Oh, my God. Yeah, so what a piece of shit.
Yep. He was sued, and he served 18 months. He did 2,400 hours of community service, paid $62,000 in fines for a rent scheme. He also threatened to, but never did sue, Bob Dylan for the song, calling it a total lie and saying it had no effect on his life. He called Dylan a scum of a scumbag. Billy Zanzinger died in 2009. The song is still performed today.
Get the fuck out of here, Billy.
So basically, he didn't like it that Bob Dylan, who at the time wrote and performed songs about this type of subject matter, and he didn't like the fact that he wrote it and basically told the truth behind Zanzinger's crazy ass antics.
Oh, he was racist as fuck. fucking straight white supremacist, this guy.
Yeah, exactly. But a good line from the song is, "Oh, but you who philosophize disgrace and criticize all fears, bury the rag deep in your face, for now's the time for your tears." Mm. Which is really powerful.
Yeah, actually. But it's not as good as "Scum of a Scumbag." Dagnabbit you, Bob Dylan. Oh, come here, wife. Oh, no. Stop listening to it. I got to tune you up a little bit because I'm mad.
So now Billy Zantzinger has gone from Cal from Titanic to Yosemite Sam.
Yeah, right. Just like, or Foghorn Leghorn. Well, I don't know.
Scum of a scumbag. Scum of a scumbag kind of lowered his ability to, I don't know, come up with good insults.
Exactly.
You ass cheek of an ass.
Yeah, you pricky cock.
Yeah.
As we would say, he was not good at a read, that's for sure.
Yeah. So let's see. What else? Did anybody think of any songs at all that are murder songs that you happen to like?
Well, there's...
Other than the one that Acadia performed at the beginning?
Oh, that is a good one. Yeah, I do like that one. But I just wanted to point out that Barry Manilow wrote, or I guess he didn't write it. I guess it was with maybe Paul Williams or something, but it was Copacabana as a murder song.
I didn't really think about that either, because...
And I hadn't even thought about that until you shared it with me. And it's like, when you go back and listen, it's...
Yeah.
You realize, oh, wow, well, it is a murder song.
Rico wore a diamond. Tony was bartending bar. And Rico hit on Lola. And Tony didn't like that. And so Tony was like, "Hey, I'm going to knock your lights out." And Rico's like, "Fuck that. I'm going to kill you." And then Lola went crazy and just basically... drowned her sorrows in a bottle. I don't know whatever happened to Rico, though. Never did find that out. They should do a movie on it.
Well, I think Gerardo wrote a song about him in the 80s, Rico Suave. Yep.
It's true. They never said it wasn't Rico Suave.
They did it. I guess Rico did all right then, I suppose. Mm-hmm. Just like all of our other stories, turns out that, you know, if you kill somebody, you're good.
Yeah, just going to everything... be fine.
You're good. Don't even sweat it. Everything's fine. Seriously, don't kill anybody, though, please.
Don't. Well.
Yeah, don't do that.
I mean.
Unless you have to.
I don't want to tell people what to do. No.
What she means by that is self-defense, people. Okay? Self-defense. Yeah,
like if you're in your panic room and things are starting to go south, then you got to, you know, do what you got to do. But
you got to figure it out.
But like, so off the top of my head, I can think of two murder songs. Okay, well, no, three murder songs.
What do you got?
Two are Bruce Springsteen songs. Nebraska is about Charles Starkweather.
Yep.
Riding through, shooting everybody.
I did not know that.
With his gal. The Starkweather murders were, and they were young kids. I mean, I think she was like 15. And that Nebraska was the album that he recorded just by himself. Like, he did all the parts. Like, he went away from the E Street Band and everything. And he just wrote a song about a spree killer. And
oh, wow.
So if you listen to the words of that, it's pretty fucking great, because it really does sort of encapsulate the whole thing.
Okay, so if you don't know who Charles Starkweather is... this guy was, he was 19 years old. Yep. And I think his sister,
his
girlfriend was 14.
Yeah. All right. I knew she was young.
That's such a weird stuff going on back then. Yeah. This is like the 1950s. This was going on. He killed a mother, stepfather, and 2-year-old sister of his girlfriend, Carol Ann Fugate. So, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Sure.
Yikes.
Murder and stuff.
Yeah, right.
Well, I know, and forgive me, I don't know if y'all realize I'm Southern, but I know two songs that are country songs. They're not about, like, famous murders, per se, but they are songs about murder. And I don't want to hear any laughing when I tell you which songs came to mind for me. So you got that, Acadia?
I promise.
Goodbye, Earl by the Dixie Chicks.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite songs of all time.
That's a great song.
You like those Black Eyed Peas?
Yep.
Okay. Marianne and Wanda were the best of friends. I'm gonna stop right now because I can't sing. Okay.
What else you got? What else you got, country girl?
The other one, and I have to say, she is a lady from my home state and highly revered around those parts, Miss Reba McEntire, the night the lights went out in Georgia. And
didn't Vicki Lawrence originally do that?
Probably, but I only know Reba McEntire because she is the queen.
Ah. Okay. Yes, she is. Yeah.
But I will tell you right now, I have fond memories of this song as a youngster where I would just belt it out. And, you know, my mom would always say, you have a unique voice.
And, she's so nice.
But let's try to not go to school and sing about killing your brother's girlfriend or wife.
Right.
So, but man, I'm going to tell you what, that used to be my jam. It used to be my jam.
Yeah. That's funny because it used to be mine too, but it was the Vicki Lawrence version because there's a little bit of age difference going on there. But another fun thing is that discovering that Vicki Lawrence, who sang that song, is also the same one from Mama's Family.
Yes, and I love Mama's Family. Yeah.
I didn't know she sang songs.
Yes, she sang the lights went out in Georgia.
Oh. Yeah. Neat.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Of course.
So she's like insanely talented.
Yes, Mama's Family is one of my favorite shows.
She's a national treasure.
I have a couple of other country songs. Sorry, guys. I grew up in the South.
Oh, no. I'm like guessing. I'm guessing which one. I'm waiting for you to say the one.
I'm just waiting to hear some spit hit a spittoon.
Here we go. Dun, dun, dun. And the thunder rolls.
Yes.
And the lightning strikes. Dun, 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 dun. Another heart grows cold.
Well, you had to throw some Garth Brooks in there.
Sweet
of course.
Lord. When you edit this, can you replace all that singing with someone hitting a cat with a banjo?
Hey,
no!
Watch it.
Don't ever hit a cat with a banjo. Never do that.
It's a sound effect.
Don't do that.
I didn't mean...
No, it's. don't
and the last one I have, which I guess I'll spare you from singing it, even though I like it,
you
is by Miranda Lambert, and it's Gunpowder and Lead. So that's another one I like. I think that's the one where she kills the abusive boyfriend. So
there are a lot of murder songs out there.
It's called
in the country world.
I mean, if you think about it. Well, yeah, but yeah. I mean, there's not a lot. It's like, why are most of the TV shows about cops or doctors? Because unless like life and death is on the line, it's kind of not that interesting.
True.
You know what I mean? Like, you got to always up the ante for shit. I think my
you
other
mean
ones.
Unrequited love is not.
Well, yeah, but I mean, I'm sad.
It's not.
And then what happens? They get so sad that they kill somebody. So there's always the second part of it. Johnny 99 from the Nebraska album was also a murder song.
Yep.
Because he got a gun
Johnny
shot
99?
A night clerk. Now they call him Johnny 99.
Oh, shit. Really? I did not know that.
Mm-hmm. That whole album is just marvelous. But, and actually... Now that a lot of Bruce Springsteen songs have murders in them, like Lost in the Flood is like about a big fucking shootout. But the one that the sleeper that no one remembers, which is my favorite song of his of all time, Twitter star, a current Twitter star and 80s and early 90s pop idol Richard Marx had a murder song. Do you remember? I swear I left her by that river.
Oh, that's right. That is a good one. Yes. I
forgot about that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I didn't even remember that. I'm not sure I ever even knew it was about murder.
Yep. They thought he did it.
Oh,
that's why he says, I swear I left her safe and sound.
He did it. You know he did it.
Yeah, probably.
I just say that, though, because that's... You know, I think everybody's did
well, it. Well, time's up, so obviously he did it. And then the only other one that I would like to to comment on, if it's okay with you guys, is the one of the ones from your list is El Paso by Marty Robbins. Which,
oh, the late great Marty Robbins.
If you can pull it off, might possibly be the best karaoke song ever. Because it is super, super, and maybe you can cut a piece into it. But it's another one of, like, it's, country songs are great. Like that one you said, it was Gunpowder and Lead. Gee, I wonder what it's about. Country songs just tell you what they're about. You know what I mean? Like, it's there's no ambiguity. Yeah. You can always understand all the words. They got it knocked. But that one is about, he loves this gal named Felina. And,
oh, that's right. And, yes.
She is, like, talking to some other dude. So he says, well, let's have a shootout. And he kills him in like 1 second, and then he says, ah, fuck, I gotta go. And he leaves, and then he loves her too much and comes back to get her, but the posse was waiting for him. And he says, maybe tomorrow a bullet may find me. Tonight nothing's worse than this pain in my chest. And then he, like, rides down the hill and gets fucking pumped full of lead. And then at the end of it, Helene is like, hey, here I am. Why didn't you just write a letter? I would have come to you. I didn't think of that.
That is such a great song, though. Yeah, I think
really
I have
is.
Heard
and
it at karaoke.
And it's got that
a lot of times.
Part that, like, is really tough to stay on key for. But if you can do it, then you'll slay all the drunks in the karaoke. Yay.
So I wanted to say too that before we wrap this up, that there are 22 songs that reference Ted Bundy. There are 54 songs that reference Jeffrey Dahmer, and there are 54 songs that reference David Berkowitz, son of Sam. Did you know that? I did not know this.
And I've been on a personal mission to find every single of these 22 Ted Bundy songs.
Well, that's a weird mission.
It's not, because I don't know if you realize this, but I had this crazy obsession with everything Ted Bundy for some reason. He captivated me, and I need to hear all of these songs about Ted Bundy.
Are you like one of the people that Netflix yelled at?
No. I am not in love with Ted Bundy. I do not excuse anything that he did. It's the whole, go listen to Ted Talk. Go listen to that if you want to hear my thoughts on Ted Bundy. It's the whole Ted Bundy package that for some reason just, it blows my mind. Acadia, nice. It blows my mind, and it's really just a captivating story. You know,
well, that's because it's one of those things where you think about that you don't know. This guy seems like a nice guy. He seems like an awkward, cute little bumbling guy with his arm and his
nerd.
Cast dropping his books all over, and you're like, no, he's not ugly. Let me go help him.
Just
you
like
know?
That poor fucker with a cast in his arm on his arm trying to put his chair in the back of the van. Oh no, that was Silence of the Lambs.
That is, and do you know? Okay, fun fact, Silence of the Lambs is based upon some aspects of Ted Bundy. The tricking, the way that Buffalo Bill got the girl, and then also from Hannibal helping them profile Buffalo Bill, because that's what Ted Bundy also did when he was on, you know, death row, and towards the end of his life, he helped the FBI profile serial killers. So it's funny because it's loosely kind of taken a lot of the Ted Bundy themes and things that happened with the Ted Bundy case, and they made it into a very successful movie.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, and I think that the Silence of the Lambs also referenced, I think, was also inspired some by Ed Gein's murder.
Yes, of course. Yep. with yeah, yeah.
Was she a big fat person?
And that Mudvayne did a song actually that was about Ed Gein also. So there's that.
Oh, you know what else is a murder song? My what? Name is Mud.
Is it Primus?
Yeah.
My name is Mud.
We
is
had
a murder
our
song.
Words a common spat. So I kissed him upside the cranium with an aluminum baseball bat. Oh, my name is Mud.
Oh my gosh. I'm fairly certain that there are a lot of murder songs out there that we don't realize
that's
are
true.
Actually murder
because
songs.
Because now I'm thinking like Buenos Tardes Amigos by Wayne is also a really good one because he did, you know, try to sell him a chicken with poison interlaced in some meats. You know? So that's about...
After further review, all songs are about either killing or fucking, or both.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Also, you better update your list there, because now there's 55 Jeffrey Dahmer songs, because I just did another one.
That's right. Yes, that is right. And oh my God, Foster the People, Pumped Up, what's the name of that song?
Pumped Up Kicks.
Pump Up the Kicks.
Let me tell
you. Yeah, Reebok Air Pumps or whatever.
Yes. So Foster the People, they're one of my favorite bands. But
oh, they're great.
This song, it's very interesting to me because you listen to the tune, you listen to the music, it's so catchy. It's like just this fun beat. You want to be happy when you're listening to it, right? Because it's just this, yeah, woo. But then if you actually dissect the lyrics.
Well, yeah, that's how they get you.
Whoa, okay,
yep.
Well.
That's how the government gets you.
And I think there was
get you to accept all of these shootings and like making you go out and dance to it.
Well, do you know? Here's a little trivia for you. I guess I'll play us off with a little murder song trivia.
Hmm.
What was the first song written about a mass shooting committed by a kid?
Oh, may I answer that question?
Well, yeah, because that's kind of how
you
it
buzzed
goes.
In first.
Okay, buzz. A silicon chip inside her
that's
head
right.
gets switched to overload.
I don't like Mondays by the Boomtown Rats.
Wow. Today. Oh man, that is just the best album.
And when they asked her, and it happened in Britain. It did not happen in the U.S.
I thought it did happen. You don't want to.
Oh no, yeah, no, wait! It did happen in the U.S., didn't it? Yeah, no, it did. Yeah, because there's no guns in Britain. There's no guns and no rabies. But when they asked her why she did it, she said, I don't like Mondays.
Yeah.
And then later on, Bob Geldof made Live Aid. So those were the two things he did.
Wow. Well, I don't want to tell you what my answer was going to be to that.
What was it? I don't want to hear it. I hear your wrong answer.
Jeremy Spoken.
Oh, that's good.
That's right. So many. There's more than I ever even knew. Mm-hmm. So
clearly I remember.
Well, I guess we're done with this today because we're out of time. I'm just gonna probably list some stuff on social media about murder songs. Just every time I think of a murder song, I'm just gonna pop it out there or something. What should we do? Should we do something fun?
I will one up you and say if you follow Senator Acadia on Spotify, that I will start making a murder song playlist.
Oh, that's a great idea. I'll link it. Get that playlist going and so I can share it with everybody. That's a really great idea. Let's do it. So songs about murder, I love it.
You could tap into a lot of Johnny Cash for murder songs as well.
I should probably come up with something for the Killer Karaoke this week. So Acadia, I'm kind of banking on you to help out with this.
Well, I can just
murder song was
tack
great.
A few more verses about other people on that one
it.
Song I already did.
Yes, please.
please include a Ted Bundy verse.
No, I'm not feeding your weird obsession. If there's going to be any Bundy in it, it's going to be Al Bundy complaining about his shoe store job.
No matter what you do with that song, you can't do worse than Crash Test Dummies because they're a terrible band. I've never liked them.
Yeah, but that song is gold.
That was
gold.
You made it better, honestly. I'll be quite frank with this, but all right. Well, thanks everybody for listening. Please come back again. Leave us a review or 5 beautiful stars on iTunes. If you don't like us, hit me up. Slide in my DMs on the Twitter and let me know what we can do better. Thank you, Mells Bells, for joining us again. I hope that you join us again.
You know I will, and I'll be polishing this singing voice just for y'all.
Yeah, that's what we can practice together. We can annoy everybody.
Oh, and if your advice on how we can do better is to, like the guy told me on PlayStation the other day, kill myself, you piece of human dog shit. You don't have to tell me because that guy on PlayStation already told me.
Oh, that's
terrible.
That's really helpful feedback right there, actually.
Thank you. All right.
You needed any feedback at all. Just tell me to kill myself. Yeah. It's cool. But I don't mind. That's okay. So there's that. We want to thank the Bad Man, who actually opened for Foster the People a couple months ago. And they did our theme music. Thank you, Gee Gee Caffeine, for doing our research today. And, yeah, I think that's it. Oh, we're on Patreon. Come to Patreon. Help us out if you're able to. We would love that.
Yep.
Any plugs, Acadia?
Yeah, go to strangefulthings.com and listen to that, and go to Superficial Gallery and read all the stuff that Mels and I make. Yeah, we got a whole bunch of shit going on. Follow me at Acadia on Twitter, because my Twitter is just Acadia, because I got it on like the second day.
You did it right.
Yeah, and then I didn't use it for like 5 years, but whatever. And I don't know, just say hi, because the whole reason that we're on there is to talk to people. So if you don't talk, then it's just kind of crazy and wasted.
It gets lonely out there, everybody. So thank you so much again for listening, and we love you. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Once there was this guy who really got pissed off because he lost the Civil War, and he went to a theater and then murdered the guy on the penny. The only thing he said was six emperor tyrannies. Massachusetts with her sister, dad, and stepmom, and one she got real pissed off and chopped her parents up with a hatchet. They couldn't pin it on her, and she spent all their money. Some slaves by pouring acid in their noggins, but that idea was stupid, so he just killed them in his apartment. And then he made it worse by eating up their corpses. Part means more when you just ate the corpses.